Avro Vulcan. The Avro Vulcan is a jet-powered Tailless delta-wing high-altitude strategic bomber, which was operated by the Royal Air Force from 1956 until 1984. Aircraft manufacturer Avro and Company designed the Vulcan in response to Specification B.35-46. Of the three V bombers produced, the Vulcan was considered the most technically advanced and hence the riskiest option. Several reduced-scale aircraft, designated Avro 707, were produced to test and refine the delta wing design principles. The Vulcan B.1 was first delivered to the RAF in 1956. Deliveries of the improved Vulcan B.2 started in 1960. The B.2 featured more powerful engines, a larger wing, an improved electrical system and electronic countermeasures. Many were modified to accept the Blue Steel missile. As a part of the V-Force, the Vulcan was the backbone of the United Kingdom's airborne nuclear deterrent during much of the Cold War. Although the Vulcan was typically armed with nuclear weapons, it was capable of conventional bombing missions, a capability which was used in Operation Blackbuck during the Falklands War between the United Kingdom and Argentina in 1982. The Vulcan had no defensive weaponry, initially relying upon high-speed high-altitude flight to evade interception. Electronic countermeasures were employed via the B.1 and B.2 from circa 1960. A change to low-level tactics was made in the mid-1960s. In the mid-1970s, 9 Vulcans were adapted for maritime radar reconnaissance operations, redesignated as B.2. In the final years of service, 6 Vulcans were converted to the K.2 tanker configuration for aerial refueling. After retirement by the RAF, one example, B.2XH-558, named the Spirit of Great Britain, was restored for use in display flights and air shows, whilst 2 other B.2s, XL-426 and XM-655, have been kept in taxiable condition for ground runs and demonstrations at London Southend Airport and Wellesbourne Mountford Airfield respectively. B.2XH-558 flew for the last time in October 2015. Before also being kept in taxiable condition at Doncaster Sheffield Airport. The origin of the Vulcan and the other V-bombers is linked with early British atomic weapon program and nuclear deterrent policies. Britain's atom bomb program began with Air Staff Operational Requirement or .1001 issued in August 1946. This anticipated a government decision in January 1947 to authorize research and development work on atomic weapons, the U.S. Atomic Energy Act of 1946 having prohibited exporting atomic knowledge, even to countries that had collaborated on the Manhattan Project. Or .1001 envisaged a weapon not to exceed in length, in diameter and in weight. The weapon had to be suitable for release from two. In January 1947, the Ministry of Supply distributed Specification B.3546 to UK aviation companies to satisfy Air Staff Operational Requirement or .229 for a medium-range bomber landplane capable of carrying one bomb to a target from a base which may be anywhere in the world. A cruising speed of at heights between and was specified. The maximum weight when fully loaded ought not to exceed. In addition to a special bomb, the aircraft was to be capable of alternatively carrying a conventional bomb load of. The similar or .230 required a long-range bomber with a radius of action with a maximum weight of when fully loaded. This requirement was considered too exacting. A total of 6 companies submitted technical brochures to this specification, including Avro. Required to tender by the end of April 1947, work began on receipt of specification B.3546 at Avro, led by Technical Director Roy Chadwick and Chief Designer Stuart Davis. The type designation was Avro 698. It was obvious to the design team that conventional aircraft could not satisfy the specification, knowing little about high-speed flight and unable to glean much from the Royal Aircraft Establishment or the U.S., they investigated German Second World War swept wing research. The team estimated that an otherwise conventional aircraft, with a swept wing of 45 degrees, would have doubled the weight requirement. Realizing that swept wings increase longitudinal stability, the team deleted the tail and the supporting fuselage. It thus became a swept-back flying wing with only a rudimentary forward fuselage and a fin at each wingtip. The estimated weight was now only 50% over the requirement. A delta shape resulted from reducing the wingspan and maintaining the wing area by filling in the space between the wingtips, which enabled the specification to be met. Though Alexander Lippisch is generally credited as the pioneer of the delta wing, Chadwick's team had followed its own logical design process. The initial design submission had four large turbojets stacked in pairs buried in the wing either side of the center line. Outboard of the engines were two bomb bays. In August 1947, Chadwick was killed in the crash of the Avro Tudor II prototype and was succeeded by Sir William Farran. Reductions in wing thickness made it impossible to incorporate the split bomb bays and stacked engines, thus the engines were placed side by side in pairs either side of a single bomb bay, with the fuselage growing somewhat. The wingtip fins gave way to a single fin on the aircraft's centerline. Rival manufacturer Handley Page received a prototype contract for its crescent-winged HP.80B.3546 tender in November 1947. Though considered the best option, contract placement for Avro's design was delayed whilst its technical strength was established. Instructions to proceed with the construction of two Avro 698 prototypes was received in January 1948. As an insurance measure against both radical designs failing, Short Brothers received a contract for the prototype SA.4 to the less stringent specification B.1446. The SA.4, later named Sparin, was not required. In April 1948, Vickers also received authority to proceed with their Type 660, which, although falling short of the B.3546 specification, being of a more conventional design, would be available sooner. This plane entered service as the Valiant. As Avro had no flight experience of the Delta Wing, the company planned two smaller experimental aircraft based on the 698, the 1/3 scale Model 707 for low-speed handling and the 1/2 scale Model 710 for high-speed handling. Two of each were ordered. However, the 710 was cancelled when it was considered too time-consuming to develop. A high-speed variant of the 707 was designed in its place, the 707A. The first 707, VX-784, flew in September 1949 but crashed later that month, killing Avro test pilot FLT Lieutenant Eric Esseler. The second low-speed 707, VX-790, built with the still uncompleted 707A's nose section and redesignated 707B, flew in September 1950 piloted by Avro test pilot WG Commander Roland Rolly Falk. The high-speed 707A, WD-480, followed in July 1951. Due to the delay of the 707 program, the contribution of the 707B and 707A towards the basic design of the 698 was not considered significant, though it did highlight a need to increase the length of the nosewheel to give a ground incidence of 3.5 degrees, the optimum takeoff attitude. The 707B and 707A proved the design's validity and gave confidence in the Delta plan form. A second 707A, WZ-736, and a two-seat 707C, WZ-744, were also constructed, but they played no part in the 698's development. More influential than the 707 in the 698's design was wind tunnel testing performed by the Royal Aircraft Establishment at Farnborough, which indicated the need for a wing redesign to avoid the onset of compressibility drag which would have restricted the maximum speed. Painted gloss white, the 698 prototype VX-770 flew for the first time on August 30, 1952, piloted by Rolly Falk flying solo. The prototype 698, then fitted with only the first pilot's ejection seat and a conventional control wheel, was powered by four Rolls-Royce RA.3 Avon engines of thrust. There were no wing fuel tanks, temporary tankage was carried in the bomb bay. VX-770 made an appearance at the 1952 Society of British Aircraft Constructors Farnborough Air Show the next month when Falk demonstrated an almost vertical bank. After its Farnborough appearance, the future name of the Avro 698 was a subject of speculation. Avro had strongly recommended the name Ottawa, in honor of the company's connection with Avro Canada. Weekly magazine Flight suggested Albion after rejecting Avenger, Apollo and Assegai. The chief of the air staff preferred a V-class of bombers, and the Air Council announced the following month that the 698 would be called Vulcan after the Roman god of fire and destruction. In January 1953, VX-770 was grounded for the installation of wing fuel tanks, Armstrong Siddeley ASA.6 Sapphire engines of thrust and other systems. It flew again in July 1953. The second prototype, VX-777, flew in September 1953. More representative of production aircraft, it was lengthened to accommodate a longer nose undercarriage leg, featured a visual bomb-aiming blister under the cabin and was fitted with Bristol Olympus 100 engines of thrust. At Falk's suggestion, a fighter-style control stick replaced the control wheel. Both prototypes had almost pure delta wings with straight leading edges. During trials in July 1954, VX-777 was substantially damaged in a heavy landing at Farnborough. It was repaired and fitted with Olympus 101 engines of thrust before resuming trials in October 1955. While exploring the high-speed and high-altitude flight envelope, mild buffeting and other undesirable flight characteristics were experienced while approaching the speed of sound, including an alarming tendency to enter an uncontrollable dive, unacceptable to the airplane and armament experimental establishment at Boscombe Down. The solution included the Phase 2 wing, featuring a kinked and drooped leading edge and vortex generators on the upper surface, first tested on 707AWD-480. An auto-mock trimmer was introduced to give a nose-up pitching moment, but more than was necessary just to counteract the diving tendency, so that the control column had to be pushed rather than pulled to maintain level flight. This artificial pitch-up made the Vulcan appear more like other aircraft as the speed increased. Meanwhile, the first production B.1, XA-889, had flown in February 1955 with the original wing. In September 1955, Falk, flying the second production B.1 XA-890, amazed crowds at the Farnborough Airshow by executing a barrel roll on his second flypast in front of the SPAC president's tent. After 2 days flying, he was called in front of service and civil aviation authorities and ordered to refrain from carrying out this dangerous maneuver. Now fitted with a Phase 2 wing, XA-889 was delivered in March 1956 to the ANA for trials for the type's initial certificate of airworthiness, which it received the following month. The first 15 B.1s were powered by the Olympus 101 with thrust. Many of these early examples in a metallic finish remain the property of the Ministry of Supply, being retained for trials and development purposes. Those entering RAF service were delivered to No. 230 Operational Conversion Unit, the first in July 1956. Later aircraft, painted in anti-flash white and powered by the Olympus 102 with thrust, began to enter squadron service in July 1957. The Olympus 102s were quickly modified to the Olympus 104 standard, ultimately rated at thrust. As far back as 1952, Bristol Aero Engines had begun development of the Bull.6 rated at thrust, but if fitted to the B.1, this would have reintroduced the buffet, requiring further redesign of the wing. The decision to proceed with the B.2 versions of the Vulcan was made in May 1956. Being developed by Avro's chief designer Roy Ewins. It was anticipated that the first B.2 would be around the 45th aircraft of the 99 then on order. As well as being able to achieve greater heights over targets, it was believed that operational flexibility could be extended by the provision of in-flight refueling equipment and tanker aircraft. The increasing sophistication of Soviet air defenses required the fitting of electronic countermeasure equipment, and vulnerability could be reduced by the introduction of the Avro Blue Steel Standoff missile, then in development. In order to develop these proposals, the second Vulcan prototype VX-777 was rebuilt with a larger and thinner Phase 2 C-wing, improved flying control surfaces and Olympus 102 engines, first flying in this configuration in August 1957. Plans were in hand to equip all Vulcans from the 16th aircraft onwards with in-flight refueling receiving equipment. AB.1, XA-903, was allocated for blue steel development work. Other B.1s were used for the development of the Bull.6, XA-891, and UAC electrical system, XA-893, and ECM, including jammers within a bulged tail cone and a tail warning radar, XA-895. The 46th production aircraft and first B.2, XH-533, first flew in September 1958 fitted with Olympus 200 engines with thrust, 6 months before the last B.1 XH-532 was delivered in March 1959. Rebuilding B.1s as B.2s was considered but rejected over cost. Nevertheless, to extend the B.1s service life, 28 were upgraded by Armstrong Whitworth between 1959 and 1963 to the B.1A standard, including features of the B.2 such as ECM equipment, in-flight refueling receiving equipment, and UHF radio. The second B.2, XH-534, flew in January 1959. Powered by production Olympus 201 with thrust, it was more representative of a production aircraft, being fitted with an in-flight refueling probe and a bulged ECM tail cone. Some subsequent B.2s were initially lacking probes and ECM tail cones, but these were fitted retrospectively. The first 10 B.2s outwardly showed their B.1 ancestry, retaining narrow engine air intakes. Anticipating even more powerful engines, the air intakes were deepened in the 11th and subsequent aircraft. Many of the early aircraft were retained for trials, and it was the 12th B.2, XH-558, that was the first to be delivered to the RAF in July 1960. Coincidentally, XH-558 would also be the last Vulcan in service with the RAF, before being retired in 1992. The 26th B.2, XL-317, the first of a production batch ordered in February 1956, was the first Vulcan, apart from development aircraft, capable of carrying the Blue Steel missile. 33 aircraft were delivered to the RAF with these modifications. When the MK.2 version of Blue Steel was cancelled in favor of the Douglas GAM-87 Skybolt air-launched ballistic missile in December 1959, fittings were changed in anticipation of the new missile, one under each wing. Though Skybolt was cancelled in November 1962, many aircraft were delivered or retrofitted with Skybolt blisters. Later aircraft were delivered with Olympus 301 engines with thrust. Two earlier aircraft were re-engined for trials and development work. Another seven aircraft were converted around 1963. The last B.2 XM-657 was delivered in 1965, and the type served till 1984. Whilst in service, the B.2 was continuously updated with modifications including rapid engine starting, bomb bay fuel tanks, wing strengthening to give the fatigue life to enable the aircraft to fly at low level, upgraded navigation equipment, deranged following radar, standardization on a common nuclear weapon and improved ECM equipment. The B.1s were not strengthened, thus all were withdrawn by 1968. Nine B.2s were modified for a maritime radar reconnaissance role and six for an airborne tanker role. An updated bomb rack assembly allowed the carriage of 31,000 pounds bombs, up from 21, and the updated wing profile increased range to 4,000 nm. The Avro 718 was a 1951 proposal for a delta-winged military transport based on the Type 698 to carry 80 troops or 110 passengers. It would have been powered by four Bristol Olympus Bull.3 engines. The Avro Type 722 Atlantic was a 1952 proposal for a 120-passenger delta-winged airliner based on the Type 698. The Avro 732 was a 1956 proposal for a supersonic development of the Vulcan and would have been powered by eight de Havilland Gyron Jr. engines. Unlike the proposed Avro 721 low-level bomber of 1952 or the Avro 730 supersonic stainless steel canard bomber dating from 1954, the Type 732 showed its Vulcan heritage. In 1960, the air staff approached Avro with a request into a study for a patrol missile carrier armed with up to six Skybolt missiles capable of a mission length of 12 hours. Avro's submission in May 1960 was the Phase 6 Vulcan, which if built would have been the Vulcan B.3. The aircraft was fitted with an enlarged wing off span with increased fuel capacity, additional fuel tanks in a dorsal spine, a new main undercarriage to carry an all-up weight of, and reheated Olympus 301 soft thrust. An amended proposal of October 1960 inserted a plug into the forward fuselage with capacity for six crew members including a relief pilot, all facing forwards on ejection seats, and aft fan versions of the Olympus 301. Other countries expressed interest in purchasing Vulcans but, as with the other V-bombers, no foreign sales materialized. As early as 1954, Australia recognized that the English Electric Canberra was becoming outdated and evaluated aircraft such as the Avro Vulcan and Handley Page Victor as potential replacements. Political pressure for a Canberra replacement only rose to a head in 1962, at which point more modern types such as the Bechtzer II, General Dynamics F-111C, and North American A-5 Vigilante had become available. The RAF would have transferred several V-bombers, including Vulcans, for interim use by the RAF if they had purchased the TSR-2, but the RAF selected the F-111C. In the early 1980s, Argentina approached the UK with a proposal to buy a number of Vulcans. An application, made in September 1981, requested the early availability of a suitable aircraft. With some reluctance, ministers approved the export of a single aircraft but emphasized that clearance had not been given for the sale of a larger number. A letter from the British Foreign and Commonwealth Office to the Ministry of Defence in January 1982 stated that little prospect was seen of this happening without ascertaining the Argentine interest and whether such interest was genuine. On the face of it, a strike aircraft would be entirely suitable for an attack on the Falklands. Argentina invaded the Falkland Islands less than 3 months later. Despite its radical and unusual shape, the airframe was built along traditional lines. Except for the most highly stressed parts, the whole structure was manufactured from standard grades of light alloy. The airframe was broken down into a number of major assemblies: the center section, a rectangular box containing bomb bay and engine bays bounded by the front and rear spars and the wing transport joints, the intakes and center fuselage, the front fuselage, incorporating the pressure cabin, the nose, the outer wings, the leading edges, the wing trailing edge and tail end of the fuselage. The wings were not sealed and used directly as fuel tankage, but carried bladders for fuel in the void spaces of the wings, and there was a single swept tail fin with a single rudder on the trailing edge. A five-man crew, the first pilot, co-pilot, navigator radar, navigator plotter and air electronics officer was accommodated within the pressure cabin on 12 levels, the pilots sitting on Martin Baker 3K ejection seats whilst on the lower level, the other crew sat facing rearwards and would abandon aircraft via the entrance door. The original B-35/46 specification sought a jettisonable crew compartment. This requirement was removed in a subsequent amendment. The rear crew's escape system was often an issue of controversy, such as when a practical refit scheme was rejected. A rudimentary sixth seat forward of the navigator radar was provided for an additional crew member. The B.2 had an additional seventh seat opposite the sixth seat and forward of the EO. These seats were no more than cushions, a full harness and an oxygen and intercom facility. The visual bomb aimer's compartment could be fitted with a T4 bomb sight. In many B.2s, this space housed a vertically mounted Vinton F95 MK.10 camera for assessing simulated low-level bombing runs. Fuel was carried in 14 bag tanks, 4 in the center fuselage above and to the rear of the nose wheel bay and 5 in each outer wing. The tanks were split into 4 groups of almost equal capacity, each normally feeding its respective engine though cross-feeding was possible. The center of gravity was automatically maintained by electric timers which sequenced the booster pumps on the tanks. B.2 aircraft could be fitted with 1 or 2 additional fuel tanks in the bomb bay. Despite being designed before a low radar cross-section and other stealth factors were ever a consideration, a Royal Aircraft Establishment technical note of 1957 stated that of all the aircraft so far studied, the Vulcan appeared by far the simplest radar echoing object. Due to its shape, only 1 or 2 components contributed significantly to the echo at any aspect, compared with 3 or more on most other types. The 2 prototype Vulcans were finished in gloss white. Early Vulcan B.1s left the factory in a natural metal finish, the front half of the nose radome was painted black, the rear half painted silver. Frontline Vulcan B.1s had a finish of anti-flash white and RAF Type D roundels. Frontline Vulcan B.1s and B.2s were similar but with Type D pale roundels. With the adoption of low-level attack profiles in the mid-1960s, B.1s and B.2s were given a glossy sea gray medium and dark green disruptive pattern camouflage in the upper surfaces, white undersurfaces and Type D roundels. In the mid-1970s, Vulcan B.2s received a similar scheme with matte camouflage, light aircraft gray undersides, and low visibility roundels. B.2s received a similar scheme in gloss, and the front half of the radomes were no longer painted black. Beginning in 1979, 10 Vulcans received a wraparound camouflage of dark sea gray and dark green because, during red flag exercises in the U.S., defending SAM forces had found that the gray-painted undersides off the Vulcan became much more visible against the ground at high angles of bank. The original Vulcan B.1 radio fit was 2 10-channel VHF transmitter/receivers and a 24-channel HF transmitter-receiver. The Vulcan B.1A also featured a UHF transmitter-receiver. The initial B.2 radio fit was similar to the B.1A though it was ultimately fitted with the ARC-52, a VUHF transmitter/receiver, and a single sideband modulation HF transmitter-receiver. The navigation and bombing system comprised an H2S MK9 radar and a navigation bombing computer MK1. Other navigation aids included a Marconi radio compass, GMK3, green satin Doppler radar to determine the ground speed and drift angle, radio and radar altimeters, and an instrument landing system. Tacken replaced G in the B.1A and B.2 in 1964. Deca Doppler 72 replaced green satin and Thebe.2 around 1969. Ref name equals PB&E 102/3 greater than price, Blackman and Edmondson 2010, pages 102, 103. Less than slash ref a continuous display of the aircraft's position was maintained via ground position indicator. Vulcan B.2s were eventually fitted with the twin gyro free-running gyroscopic heading reference system MK.2, based upon the inertial platform of the Blue Steel missile, which had been integrated into the system when the missile had been carried. With the DRS, the navigator's heading unit was provided, which enabled the navigator plotter to adjust the aircraft heading, through the autopilot, by as little as 0.1 degrees. The B.2 was additionally fitted with the Loran C navigation system. The original ECM fit is fitted to the B.1A and B.2 was 1 green palm voice communications jammer, 2 blue divermetric jammers, 3 red shrimp S-band jammers, a blue Saga passive warning receiver with 4 aerials, a red steer tail warning radar, and window dispensers. The bulk of the equipment was carried in a large extended tail cone, and a flat ECM aerial counterpoise plate mounted between the starboard tailpipes. Later equipment on the B.2 included an L-band jammer, the RE18146 X-band jammer, replacing the green palm, the improved red steer MK.2, infrared decoys, and the RE18228 power with its aerials that gave a squared top to the fin. The aircraft was controlled by a fighter-type control stick and rudder bar which operated the powered flying controls. Each PFC had a single electro-hydraulic-powered flying control unit except the rudder, which had two, one running as a backup. Artificial feel and auto-stabilization in the form of pitch and yaw dampers were provided, as well as an auto-mock trimmer. The flight instruments in the B.1 were traditional and included G4B compasses, MK.4 artificial horizons, and zero reader flight display instruments. The B.1 had a Smith's MK-10 autopilot. In the B.2, these features were incorporated into the Smith's military flight system, the pilot's components being 2 beam compasses, 2 director horizons, and a MK.10A or MK.10B autopilot. From 1966, B.2s were fitted with the RE5959 terrain following radar, built by General Dynamics, its commands being fed into the director horizons. The B.1 had 4 elevators and 4 ailerons. In the B.2, these were replaced by 8 elevons. The Vulcan was also fitted with 6 electrically operated 3-position air brakes, 4 in the upper center section and 2 in the lower. There were originally 4 lower air brakes, but the outboard 2 were deleted before the aircraft entered service. A brake parachute was installed inside a tail cone. The main electrical system on the B.1/B.1A was 112 VDC supplied by 4 22.5 kilowatts engine-driven starter generators. Backup power was provided by 4 24 volts 40 ah batteries connected in series providing 96 V. Secondary electrical systems were 28 VDC, single-phase 115 V AC at 1600 Hz, and three-phase 115 V AC at 400 Hz, driven by transformers and inverters from the main system. The 28 VDC system was backed up by a single 24 V battery. For greater efficiency and higher reliability, the main system on the B.2 was changed to three-phase 200 VAC at 400 Hz supplied by 440 kV engine-driven constant-speed alternators. Engine starting was then by air starters supplied from a Palouste compressor on the ground. Standby supplies in the event of a main AC failure were provided by a ram air turbine driving a 17 kV alternator that could operate from high altitudes down to, and an airborne auxiliary power plant, a rover gas turbine driving a 40 kV alternator, which could be started once the aircraft was below an altitude of. Secondary electrical supplies were by transformer rectifier units for 28 VDC and rotary frequency converters for the 115 V 1600 Hz single-phase supplies. The change to an AC system was a significant improvement. The Vulcan's powered flying controls were hydraulically actuated, but each powered flying control unit had a hydraulic pump which was driven by an electric motor. Because there was no manual reversion, a total electrical failure would result in a loss of control. The standby batteries on the B.1 were designed to give enough power for 20 minutes of flying time, but this proved to be optimistic and two aircraft, XA-891 and XA-908, crashed as a result. The main hydraulic system provided pressure for undercarriage raising and lowering and bogey trim, nose wheel centering and steering, wheel brakes, bomb doors opening and closing, and op air scoop lowering. Hydraulic pressure was provided by three hydraulic pumps fitted to numbers 1, 2 and 3 engines. An electrically operated hydraulic power pack could be used to operate the bomb doors and recharge the brake accumulators. A compressed air system was provided for emergency undercarriage lowering. The Rolls-Royce Olympus, originally known as the Bristol B.10 Olympus, is a two-spool axial flow turbojet that powered the Vulcan. Each Vulcan had four engines buried in the wings, positioned in pairs close to the fuselage. The engine's design began in 1947, intended to power the Bristol Aeroplane Company's own rival design to the Vulcan. A serendipitous arrangement in air intakes could cause the Vulcan to emit a distinctive howl when the engines were at approximately 90% power, which can be heard as the aircraft performs a flypast, such as at public air shows. As the prototype Vulcan VX-770 was ready for flight prior to the Olympus being available, it first flew using Rolls-Royce Avon R8.3 engines of thrust. These were quickly replaced by Armstrong Siddeley Sapphire R6 engines of thrust. VX-770 later became a flying testbed for the Rolls-Royce Conway. The second prototype VX-777 first flew with Olympus 100s of thrust. It was subsequently re-engined with Olympus 101 engines of thrust. When VX-777 flew with a Phase 2 C wing in 1957, it was fitted with Olympus 102 engines of thrust. Early B.1s were engined with the Olympus 101. Later aircraft were delivered with Olympus 102s. All Olympus 102s became the Olympus 104 of thrust on overhaul and ultimately thrust on uprating. The first B.2 flew with the second-generation Olympus 200 of thrust, design of which began in 1952. Subsequent B.2s were engined with either the uprated Olympus 201 of thrust or the Olympus 301 of thrust. The Olympus 201 was designated 202 on being fitted with a rapid air starter. The engine would later be developed into a reheated power plant for the cancelled supersonic BACTSR-2 strike bomber and the supersonic passenger transport Concorde. In September 1956, the RAF received its first Vulcan B.1, XA-897, which immediately embarked upon a round-the-world tour. The tour was to be an important demonstration of the range and capabilities of the aircraft, but it also had other benefits in the form of conducting goodwill visits in various countries. In later life, Vulcans routinely visited various nations and distant parts of the former British Empire as a show of support and military protection. This first tour, however, was struck by misfortune. On October 1, 1956, while landing in bad weather at London Heathrow Airport at the completion of the world tour, XA-897 was destroyed in a fatal accident. The first two aircraft were delivered to 230 AQ in January 1957 and the training of crews started on February 21, 1957. In the following months, more aircraft were delivered to the AQ. The first AQ course to qualify was number 1 course, on May 21, 1957, and they went on to form the first flight of number 83 Squadron. Number 83 Squadron was the first operational squadron to use the bomber, at first using borrowed Vulcans from the AQ, and on July 11, 1956 it received the first aircraft of its own. By September 1957, several Vulcans had been handed over to number 83 Squadron. The second AQ course also formed a flight of 83 Squadron, but subsequent train crews were also used to form the second bomber squadron, 101 Squadron. The last aircraft from the first batch of 25 aircraft had been delivered by the end of 1957 to 101 Squadron. In order to increase the mission range and flight time for Vulcan operations, in-flight refueling capabilities were added in 1959 onwards. Several Valiant bombers were refurbished as tankers to refuel the Vulcans. Continuous airborne patrols proved untenable, however, and the refueling mechanisms across the Vulcan fleet fell into disuse in the 1960s. Both Vulcans and the other V-Force aircraft routinely visited the Far East, in particular Singapore, where a fully equipped nuclear weapons storage facility had been constructed in 1959. During the Indonesia-Malaysia confrontation, Britain planned to deploy 3 squadrons of V-bomber aircraft and 48 Red Bear tactical nuclear weapons to the region, although this was ultimately decided against. Vulcans trained in the region for both conventional and nuclear missions. Britain regularly deployed Vulcans to the Far East as a part of their contribution to SEATO operations, often to test the defenses of friendly nations in joint exercises. In the early 1970s, the RAF decided to permanently deploy 2 squadrons of Vulcans overseas in the Near East Air Force Bomber Wing, Based at RAF Akrotiri in Cyprus, the Vulcans were withdrawn as Cypriot intercommunal violence intensified in the mid-1970s. Vulcans did some very long-range missions. In June 1961, one of them took off from RAF Scampton to Sydney, with an 18,507 kilometers long journey, flown in only a bit more than 20 hours and 3 air refuelings. Vulcans frequently visited the United States during the 1960s and 1970s to participate in air shows and static displays, as well as to participate in the Strategic Air Command's annual bombing and navigation competition at such locations as Barksdale AFB, Louisiana and the former McCoy AFB, Florida, with the RAF crews representing Bomber Command and later Strike Command. Vulcans also took part in the 1960, 1961, and 1962 Operation Sky Shield exercises, in which NORAD defenses were tested against possible Soviet air attack, the Vulcans simulating Soviet fighter-slash-bomber attacks against New York, Chicago, and Washington. The results of the tests were classified until 1997. The Vulcan proved quite successful during the 1974 Giant Voice exercise, in which it managed to avoid USAF interceptors. As part of Britain's independent nuclear deterrent, the Vulcan initially carried Britain's first nuclear weapon, the Blue Danube gravity bomb. Blue Danube was a low-kiloton yield fission bomb designed before the United States detonated the first hydrogen bomb. These were supplemented by US-owned MK5 bombs and later by the British Redbeard tactical nuclear weapon. The UK had previously embarked on its own hydrogen bomb program, and to bridge the gap until these were ready, the V-bombers were equipped with an interim megaton weapon based on the Blue Danube casing containing green grass, a large pure fission warhead of yield. This bomb was known as Violet Club. Only 5 were deployed before the green grass warhead was incorporated into a developed weapon as Yellow Sun MK.1. The later Yellow Sun MK2 was fitted with Red Snow, a British-built variant of the USW-28 warhead. Yellow Sun MK2 was the first British thermal nuclear weapon to be deployed, and was carried on both the Vulcan and Handley Page Victor. The Valiant retained U.S. nuclear weapons assigned to Sakura under dual key arrangements. Redbeard was pre-positioned in Singapore for use by Vulcan and Victor bombers. From 1962, 3 squadrons of Vulcan B.2S and 2 squadrons of Victor B.2S were armed with the Blue Steel missile, a rocket-powered standoff bomb, which was also fitted with the Yield Red Snow warhead. Operationally, RAF Bomber Command and the U.S. Strategic Air Command cooperated in the single integrated operational plan to ensure coverage of all major Soviet targets from 1958. 108 aircraft of the RAF's V-bombers were assigned targets under PSYOP by the end of 1959. From 1962 onwards, 2 jets in every major RAF base were armed with nuclear weapons and on standby permanently under the principle of quick reaction alert. Vulcans on QRA standby were to be airborne within 4 minutes of receiving an alert, as this was identified as the amount of time between warning off a USSR nuclear strike being launched and it arriving in Britain. The closest the Vulcan came to taking part in potential nuclear conflict was during the Cuban Missile Crisis in October 1962, where Bomber Command was moved to Alert Condition 3, an increased state of preparedness from normal operations. However, it stood down in early November. The Vulcans were intended to be equipped with the American Skybolt air-launched ballistic missile to replace the Blue Steel, with Vulcan B.2S carrying 2 Skybolts under the wings. The last 28 B.2S were modified on the production line to fit pylons to carry the Skybolt. A B.3 variant with increased wingspan to carry up to 6 Skybolts was proposed in 1960. When the Skybolt missile system was cancelled by U.S. President John F. Kennedy on the recommendation of his Secretary of Defense, Robert McNamara, in 1962, Blue Steel was retained to supplement it until the Royal Navy took on the deterrent role with Polaris ICBM-equipped submarines. The Vulcan bombers adopted a new mission profile of flying high during clear transit, dropping down low to avoid enemy defenses on approach, and deploying a parachute-retarded bomb, the V-177B. However, since the aircraft had been designed for high-altitude flight, at low altitudes it could not exceed 350 knots. RAF Air Vice Marshal Ron Dick, a former Vulcan pilot, said it is, thus, questionable whether it could have been effective flying at low level in a war against the Soviet Union. After the British Polaris submarines became operational and Blue Steel was taken out of service in 1970, The Vulcan continued to carry V.177B in a tactical nuclear strike role as part of the British contribution to Europe's standing NATO forces, although they no longer held aircraft at 15 minutes readiness in peacetime. Two squadrons were also stationed in Cyprus as part of the Near East Air Force and assigned to Central Treaty Organization in a strategic strike role. With the eventual demise of the V.177B and the Vulcan bombers, the Blackburn Buccaneer, Sipcat Jaguar, and Panavia Tornado continued with the V.177C until its retirement in 1998. While not a like-for-like replacement, the multi-role Tornado interdictor-slash-strike bomber is the successor for the roles previously filled by the Vulcan. Although in operational use the Vulcan typically carried various nuclear armaments, the type also had a secondary conventional role. While performing conventional combat missions, the Vulcan could carry up to 21 bombs inside its bomb bay. From the 1960s, the various Vulcan squadrons would routinely conduct conventional training missions. The aircrews were expected to be able to perform conventional bombing missions in addition to the critical nuclear strike mission the Vulcan normally performed. The Vulcan's only combat missions took place towards the end of the type's service in 1982. During the Falklands War, the Vulcan was deployed against Argentinian forces which had occupied the Falkland Islands. This conflict was the only occasion in which any of the V-bombers would participate in conventional warfare. The missions performed by the Vulcan became known as the Black Buck Raids. Each aircraft had to fly from Ascension Island to reach Stanley on the Falklands. Victor tankers conducted the necessary air-to-air refueling for the Vulcan to cover the distance involved. Approximately of fuel was used in each mission. Five Vulcans were selected to participate in the operation. In order to do so, each aircraft had to receive various last-minute adaptations, including modifications to the bomb bay, the reinstatement of the long-out-of-use in-flight refueling system, the installation of a new navigational system derived from the Vickers VK-10, and the updating of several onboard electronics. Underneath the wings, new pylons were fitted to carry an ECM pod and Shrike anti-radar missiles at wing hardpoint locations. These hardpoints had originally been installed for the purpose of carrying the cancelled Skybolt nuclear missile. Engineering work to retrofit these Vulcans had begun on 9 April. On 1 May, the first mission was conducted by a single Vulcan that flew over Port Stanley and dropped its bombs on the airfield, concentrating on the single runway, with one direct hit, making it unsuitable for fighter aircraft. The Vulcan's mission was quickly followed up by strikes against anti-air installations, flown by British Aerospace Sea Harriers from nearby Royal Navy carriers. Three Vulcan missions were flown against the airfield, a further two missions in which missiles were launched against radar installations, and additional two missions were cancelled. At the time, these missions held the record for the world's longest distance raids. The ECM systems on board the Vulcans proved to be effective at jamming Argentine radars. While a Vulcan was within the theater, other British aircraft in the vicinity had a greatly reduced chance of coming under effective fire. On June 3, 1982, Vulcan B.2 XM597 of No. 50 Squadron took part in the Black Buck 6 mission against Argentinian radar sites at Stanley Airfield on the Falkland Islands. While attempting to refuel for its return journey to Ascension Island, the probe broke, leaving the Vulcan with insufficient fuel, forcing a diversion to Galeão Air Force Base, Rio de Janeiro in neutral Brazil. En route, secret papers were dumped along with the two remaining AGM-45 Shrike missiles, although one failed to launch. After a mayday call, the Vulcan, escorted by Brazilian Air Force Northrop F-5 fighters, was permitted an emergency landing at Rio with very little fuel left on board. The Vulcan and her crew were detained until the end of hostilities 9 days later. In November 1973, as a result of the planned closure of the Victor SR.2 equipped No. 543 Squadron, No. 27 Squadron reformed at RAF Scampton equipped with the Vulcan as a replacement in the maritime radar reconnaissance role. The squadron carried out patrols of the seas around the British Isles, including the strategically important Jut Gap between Iceland and the United Kingdom, flying at high level and using the Vulcan's H2S radar to monitor shipping. In peacetime, this could be followed up by visual identification and photography of targets of interest at low level. In wartime, a Vulcan would leave visual identification of potential targets to Buccaneers or Canberras, and could coordinate attacks by Buccaneers against hostile shipping. Though initially equipped with a number of B.2 aircraft, the squadron eventually operated nine B.2 aircraft. The aircraft were modified for the role by removing the terrain following radar and adding the Loran C radio navigation aid. The main external visual difference was the presence of a gloss paint finish, with a light gray undersurface, to protect against sea spray. The squadron also inherited its secondary role of air sampling from No. 543 Squadron. This involved flying through plumes of airborne contamination and using onboard equipment to collect fallout released from both above-ground and underground nuclear tests for later analysis at the Atomic Weapons Research Establishment at Aldermaston. Five aircraft had small pylons fitted to the redundant skybolt hardpoints, which could be used to carry sampling pods modified from drop tanks. These pods would collect the needed samples on a filter, while an additional smaller localizer pod was fitted to the port wing, inboard of the main pylons. The squadron disbanded at Scampton in March 1982, passing on its radar reconnaissance duties to the RAF's Nimrods. After the end of the Falklands War in 1982, the Vulcan B.2 was due to be withdrawn from RAF service that year. However, the Falklands campaign had consumed much of the airframe fatigue life of the RAF's Victor tankers. While Vickers VC-10 tanker conversions had been ordered in 1979 and Lockheed TriStar tankers would be ordered after the conflict, as a stopgap measure, six Vulcans were converted into single-point tankers. The Vulcan tanker conversion was accomplished at by removing the jammers from the ECM bay in the tail of the aircraft, and replacing them with a single hose drum unit. An additional cylindrical bomb bay tank was fitted, making a total of three, giving a fuel capacity of almost. The go-ahead for converting the six aircraft was given on May 4, 1982. Just 50 days after being ordered, the first Vulcan tanker, XH-561, was delivered to RAF Waddington. The Vulcan K.2S were operated by No. 50 Squadron, along with three Vulcan B.2S, in support of UK air defence activities on Tailless. Was disbanded in March 1984. After the disbandment of No. 50 Squadron, two Vulcans continued flying with the RAF in air displays as part of the Vulcan display flight, based at Waddington but administered through No. 55 Squadron, based at RAF Murrum. Initially displaying using XL-426, in 1986 that aircraft was sold, having been replaced by XH-558, which began displays in 1985. The VDF continued with XH-558 until 1992. Finishing operations after the Ministry of Defence had determined it was too costly to run in light of budget cuts. Both aircraft subsequently entered preservation and survived, although a third, XH-560, kept in reserve in the first years, was later scrapped. A total of 134 production Vulcans were assembled at Woodford Aerodrome, 45 to the B.1 design and 89 were B.2 models, the last being delivered to the RAF in January 1965. In the event of transition to war, the V-bomber squadrons were to deploy four aircraft at short notice to each of 26 pre-prepared dispersal airfields around the United Kingdom. In the early 1960s, the RAF ordered 20 Beagle Basset communication aircraft to move the crews to dispersal airfields. The importance of these aircraft was only brief, diminishing when the primary nuclear deterrent switched to the Royal Navy's Polaris missile. Several Vulcans survive, housed in museums in both the United Kingdom and North America. One Vulcan, XH-558 Spirit of Great Britain, was used as a display aircraft by the RAF as part of the Vulcan display flight until 1993. After being grounded, it was later restored to flight by the Vulcan to the Sky Trust and displayed as a civilian aircraft from 2008 until 2015, before being retired a second time for engineering reasons. In retirement, XH-558 is to be retained at its base at Doncaster Sheffield Airport as a taxiable aircraft, a role already performed by two other survivors, XL-426 based at Southend Airport, and XM-655, based at Wellesbourne Mountford Airfield. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.